Yeah, thank you very much.
Oops.
Yeah, so it's a pleasure to be here. So thank you very much for the invitation. And I'm very much looking forward to sharing our recent results and our roadmap on quantum simulations of models from high energy physics with you. Before I start, let me just say I'm from IQC at the University of Waterloo, so where I'm leading the quantum optics theory group, and we still have open postdoc positions. So if you're interested or you know somebody who's interested, before I actually start with my talk, let me briefly introduce what we are doing. So we are looking into the question where we can do things that give you a quantum advantage, but not only on paper or on the whiteboard, but also in proof of concept experiments. So we are a theoretical group, but we work very closely with experiments. And our two main research tracks are quantum networks and quantum simulations. With the quantum networks, we worry and study about entanglement distribution, in particular 2D networks and robust repeater architectures, so all towards the vision of building a quantum internet. And we are also very interested in self-stabilizing quantum systems and autonomous quantum error correction. So the question really, how to keep a qubit alive and to follow the vision to get self-corrected quantum technology. And pointer, very good, thank you. Yeah, and our second research track is on quantum simulations, and this is exactly what I will talk about right now for the next 30 minutes. And in particular, this will be about quantum simulations of models from high energy physics. This entails questions as the following. So why is there more matter than antimatter in the universe? So why are we here? Yeah. Or what happens inside neutron stars? Or what happened in the very early universe? Or what happens in heavy ion collisions and particle accelerators? And to find answers to these type of questions, we need new methods for gauge theories. And yeah, unfortunately, I missed Marie Carmen's talk yesterday, but I believe she talked about these things yesterday already. So to really gauge theories, to address them, they are, of course, the backbone of our standard model and describe how fundamental particles interact at the very elementary level. And they are really hard questions, like questions which are fundamentally hard due to the sign problem. And so here are three favorite classes of problems which are really plagued by the sign problem and where no controlled methods exist. So where it really makes sense to look for sign problem-free methods, like quantum simulations, for instance. The first one is everything that is dynamical, time evolutions. Second one, so-called topological terms that can be added to the standard model in order to study, for instance, CP violations to understand better why there's more matter than antimatter. And yeah, of course, problems with high baryon density. And I'm sure Marie Carmen probably talked about this. Okay, so this all motivates, or like looking into these problems really motivates the quest to find sign problem-free methods. And there are, of course, quantum simulations and numerical methods based on tensor states. And these are really two routes towards the same goal. They are both very actively pursued. But for the purpose of this talk, I will be completely concentrating only on quantum simulations, because this what we are working in. Yeah, so this is about developing new tools for basic science. And of course, I kind of feel obliged to give a disclaimer already quite in the beginning, because I mentioned all these really big problems. Yeah, but these are only like really the motivation for the long-term vision. So the long-term vision, which is of course extremely ambitious, it would be the dream one day to have a quantum simulator who could really address quantum chromodynamics in three spatial and one temporal dimensions, and hopefully maybe even get some insights into these really big fundamental questions and to learn new physics. And this is really what is motivating and really driving this whole effort. But at the same time, it's also something that is really in the future, like in the far future, in the very far future. And for now, like what we are doing in my group and also what we have done so far and everything that I will talk about to you now, it's more on this left side. Yeah? We're completely busy developing the tools and the new concepts in the first place. Okay? So we want to develop a new type of quantum simulator, and this will of course result only in proof of concept experiments. And I'm going to talk about these type of proof of concept experiments now. And by this I mean very few qubits. Yeah, I want to manage your expectations already at this stage. And of course toy models, yeah, low dimensional models, like not quantum chromodynamics. And our focus is really on developing these concepts. So we have, of course, here quantum physics helping us already for quantum chemistry or condensed matter physics. So there's almost a whole industry on quantum simulations for this. And the question that I'm asking here, can we also develop similar quantum simulation tools, but now for problems in high energy physics? Yeah. So, there are quantum simulators. I'm talking about quantum simulators for high-energy physics, and there we have a particular set of challenges. In particular, since we want to simulate a gauge theory, all the states and dynamics should better be gauge invariant, of course. And so for me as a quantum engineer, it simply means that I'm confronted with the challenge of not realizing a complicated quantum many-body Hamiltonian. I mean, this is quite a challenge in its own right. Yeah, to convince a controlled quantum system to realize this complicated quantum many-body Hamiltonian. But I also I'm given a large set of constraints, which are representing the requirement of the states to be gauge invariant, and so this will be the Gauss law in the case of QED, for instance. So we will see more about this later. Like to stay really in the physical subspace. And like for a practical purpose, like trying to make a proof of concept quantum simulation with current technology or with near future quantum hardware, this is really a major difficulty how to do this. This is just a pictorial representation. So I have some quantum hardware which offers me a certain Hilbert space, and I really want to stay in the gauge invariant subspace, which is only a small corner, which is only a small fraction. And to step one step back and to give you the meta picture again, so this is really the aim of the game, to use current technology like trapped ions, something we're looking into in detail. As you see here, cold atoms and optical lattices also. We're working also with superconducting architectures, and we're interested in looking at individually trapped Rydberg atoms also, like technology and hardware that you have today, and really connecting these things with applications, and by application I mean interesting toy models and toy problems from this other field. Like the idea is really to bridge these two fields. Yeah, and how this looks in practice before I go into any details, we have a certain problem in high energy physics like anti-particle pair creation, string breaking, CP violations, or low dimensional toy models of these. And we are aiming to demonstrate this with most of the case. It's going to be spin models often, even though we're also looking at cold fermions, but for this purpose of this talk, it's spin models with a certain, where one can map everything to a certain spin Hamiltonian, which you implement on a demonstrator, and as you will see in the end of the day, it will end up being an experiment with a lot of mini quenches. So this will be more concrete now as the main part of the talk comes. To start out, let me already give you this little overview. I'm always going to assume that we have some sort of controllable quantum system. It doesn't have to be a full quantum computer. So I'm perfectly happy being given a quantum state preparator, which in general, it will not have a universal set of gates. Yeah, it will have a set of native gates, resource gates, which I have on a given platform. And today I'm going to talk about two different modes to operate our controlled quantum system. Here in mode A, I can use it as a trotter simulator, saying I'm interested in time evolutions, where I'm investigating like the physics questions that I'm investigating is like quench dynamics and real-time evolutions, which I said are hard with Markov chain Monte Carlo. Or I use the very same system, but I go to a different mode, mode B, which I will also introduce later. I call it a variational quantum simulator. It's also something we're doing now and also with experiments. But the physics question you ask is a very different one. Yeah. So here we are not asking for a time evolution. We're not interested in time dynamics. No, here we're interested in ground state preparation. Ah, yeah. Even so, we recently figured out also how to prepare excited states. But basically, we're looking into equilibrium physics. Okay, so, and I'm going to demonstrate everything for quantum electron dynamics in 1 plus 1 dimension as a benchmarking model, mainly because our major results are for this model, and also that is what all other quantum simulations are currently doing. And yeah, also I can demonstrate all the relevant concepts already with this simple benchmarking model. So for this, I'm going to introduce electromagnetic fields, vector potential. So in this case, it has only one spatial component and one temporal component. Then I have an electric field, and the two of them commute canonically. I'm also going to introduce matter fields. So here we have electrons, positrons, or the absence of matter. Here we have a two components Dirac spinor, and here's our Hamiltonian in the continuum. Where I have here the fermion mass, here I have electric field energy, here I have a coupling, so the kinetic term between matter and vector potential. Since I'm in one dimension, the gamma matrix is simply a Pauli matrix, and Gesundheit. And the coupling strength G is called G in my slides, but it's just the electric charge in this case. So we put the whole thing on a lattice, yeah. And in going from the continuum to the lattice, there, here the vector potential will be called theta from now on. Of course, one has to do to scale everything properly with the A, which is the lattice spacing. The electric fields will be called L. I didn't make any heads on them, but of course all of them are operators, and they still commute canonically. And a bit of care has to be taken to put the Dirac spinor on the lattice in order not to have a fermion doubling problem. And to avoid this, we take our two components Dirac spinor with fermions and antifermions, and we do it like this, yeah, to put the upper part on all the odd lattice sides, the lower part on all the even lattice sides. So by this little trick, you end up with a situation where all your lattice sides, they have only one component fermion fields, so each lattice side is occupied or unoccupied, and you can use this little translation table here. So if you have an odd side where we placed all the upper parts of the Dirac spinor, so it can be occupied, then it's a vacuum, or unoccupied, it's an electron. And for the even sides, it's like this. So if you want a particle, you have to put it on an odd side. If you want an antiparticle, you put it on an even side. And if I give you a matter configuration, occupied, unoccupied, and so on and so forth, so you can immediately translate it into a matter configuration. So our gauge fields live on the links that are connecting. The gauge fields are here in blue. They are connecting the lattice sides. And yeah, we have an electric field and a vector potential for each of these links. And here's just the Hamiltonian as we had it before, just from the continuum going to a lattice. And let me very briefly walk you through the individual terms. There's the last term here, which has a fermion rest mass, and it has this funny factors of minus 1 to the n, which came from the staggering that has been introduced. But if you evaluate this term just for this configuration, you see it evaluates to 0. It's like this term is counting how many meta fields you have. And you just pay the price that you expect. Yeah, you pay nothing for the vacuum. You pay 2m for a pair. You pay m for electron or positron. So it's just local terms. And here we have nearest neighbor particle hopping, which plays the role of particle-antiparticle creation, because if you remember our little translation table, if we start from this, would be vacuum-vacuum, this fermion hops over there, then we get this configuration, which would correspond to a particle-antiparticle pair. So this is particle production or pair annihilation, creation or annihilation. And of course, we have the electric field energy. And maybe I should mention, so here in my notation, the electric field operators, they have eigenvalues which go from minus infinity to plus infinity and take integer eigenvalues. And as I mentioned before, that's your many-body Hamiltonian, but we have also the Gauss law. If we go mentally back to three spatial dimension and to the continuum in standard quantum electrodynamics, here we would have that the divergence of the electric field is the charge density. And now if we break it down to the lattice and go to one dimension, then we have something like the difference between two neighboring electric fields is given by this function. And this is a function which represents the charge density of our funny staggered fermions. So this would be minus 1 if you have an electron. It would be a plus 1 for a positron. Or it would be 0 if you have a vacuum. So if we look at our meta, like at a configuration like this, then we immediately see, so I'm jumping about some more formal description, but we can go back to the formal description a little bit later, if you're interested in. Yeah, in the interest of time, I don't make this more rigorous, and I also don't go to 2D. I'm going to tell you now how we implement this Gauss law, like this large set of constraints that I just outlined, on actual quantum hardware. And as I said before, we're looking at two different ways of doing this, the dynamical mode or the equilibrium static mode. And I will now outline dynamical mode. Okay, and to make it even more specific, I even specify how we do it like for a specific platform. And in our case, the specific platform was trapped ions, was an experiment done in very close collaboration in Innsbruck in the group of Rainer Blatt. And what has been explored here by us was the coherent real-time dynamics, in this case of particle-antiparticle creation, so as a very paradigmatic benchmarking effect. And we also looked at entanglement that is created during this pair creation. And I'm going to leave out a lot of details. Yeah? And if you're interested in having more details, so yeah, maybe we can talk about them during the rest of the conference, or you can look at the two papers, so this experiment and theory paper, short version, or this is a longer paper with like much more details. And I should also mention like the way how we did it here. It's not an all-fits-one approach. Yeah, this was very much, we have a trapped ion quantum computer, and we want to do it with current hardware, and we have very limited resources. So the method was really adjusted to the platform. Yeah, and now we're looking, for instance, at stuff for superconducting architectures, but you should use different approaches if you use a different platform. Yeah, so I think for our near-term devices, this will be actually quite crucial. Yeah, there will be certain models which run very well on one platform, but maybe if you have another model, you might want to go to a different platform. Yeah, so trapped ions, you have long-range interactions. You don't have these long-range interactions on cold fermions, but there you have the natural commutation relations. So your problem should fit your platform, and once you have your problem, your platform and your problem, you still should adjust the method. Okay, and this method is really for this problem, and it's for trapped ions. And it's pretty efficient. So before I give you the details, here's a bird's eye overview. Our approach was mapping the Schwinger-Hamiltonian to a pure spin model with long-range interactions. So why? Because in trapped ions, long-range interactions is something that you have for free. I mean, trapped ions just have these long-range interactions. It's the main working horse that is employed there. In fact, you would have to go through some trouble to get rid of them. Okay, and this really uses this mapping or encoding that people have used, like using this encoding to take the Schwinger model to get a pure spin model only involving only meta degrees of freedom. People have used this a lot for numerical studies, and so also Marie Kamen and Ignacio have used this for numerical studies, and here it's using exactly this, but on a quantum computer, basically. And this gives you, as you will see, some crazy interactions. And this is then basically later on a quantum optics problem. Yeah, it's a quantum optics problem if you have a quantum simulator which has a certain interaction and you just want to implement a crazy interaction on it. But there's a toolbox for this, and also, yeah, we spend really a couple of years on developing this type of toolbox for implementing crazy interactions. And since I'm at the summary already, the scheme has then some interesting features. First of all, it will give you exact gauge invariants at all energy scales by construction, and as I said before, it makes good use of your quantum resources.
So what does this mean?
Sorry? Oh, this is exactly what I'm going to outline now. Before I do it, I have to make two simple transformations. The first one is we have a fermionic model, but in trapped ions you have spins. So first we're going to do a Jordan-Wigner transformation, but for now I'm talking about 1D, so there's no issue at all, yeah, with going from the fermions to the spins. And I'm also going to eliminate my vector potentials. Also this is kind of specific because I'm in 1D, I mean, so there are no magnetic field effects, so here I can do it. It will change in 2D, and this is already saying everything that I tell you now is carrying over, even though you might not think so, it's carrying over to 2D problems. Okay, so what I'm saying here is that I'm having the Hamiltonians that I had before, but now it has only electric fields, so we got rid of the vector potential and has spins instead of fermions. So here again, we have this Hamiltonian, so we had this nearest neighbor hopping, which is no nearest neighbor flip-flop. We have our local terms, and then we have here our electric fields. And our translation table, it really translates. You just think, whenever you had a occupied lattice site, you think of it as spin up and vice versa. And now comes the encoding. So how does one do this? So there was a Gauss law, and here's the spin version of the Gauss law. This is the charge density in spin language. Basically, if you have something which represents a vacuum, it just means, I mean, it's the job of the vacuum to do nothing. It doesn't change the vector, the electric fields. But if you have an electron, it decreases the electric flux, and if you have a positron, it increases it. So here's an example. And so this example will already tell you how you can get rid, or how people get rid of the electric fields in this 1D scenario. So suppose you have a background field of zero. I mean, I just choose as I could take any background field, in fact. And so here's a background field of zero, but you have an electron, which we know from the Gauss law, it reduces the flux by one. So you go from zero to minus one. Then you have a positron, so it increases again. So you see this is neutral from the outside. Ja, Vacuum, so Vacuum doesn't change electric fields. So you have an electron again, you go down one, so and you go up. So here you see you have a long extended string between a separated pair. And so here, as I walk through the chain, I never have a, there's never a question what my next electric field is, because the Gauss law tells me completely. Or in other words, I can eliminate it, or I can express all electric field operators in terms of my background field and in terms of the meta fields. Yeah, so I can just eliminate the gauge fields to get a pure spin model or a pure matter model, like in, yeah, a bit like in real life. So instead of the gauge bosons mediating the interaction, I get a long range interaction. I get an effective picture with a long range interaction. It comes at a price, though. I get a fairly ugly Hamiltonian. So ugly, yeah, well, I call it an exotic spin model. Yeah, you should serve your favorite experimentalist a cup of good coffee before you show them this Hamiltonian and asking them to realize this. Because the not so nice part is this guy here. I mean, the experimentalist will certainly not mind these local terms here, and also not the nearest neighbor flip-flop, but this is really ugly. Yeah? So it's the good thing, it's only two body interactions, and but it's like infinite range. And it looks very strange, because after the annihilation, you get an interaction which looks like this. I just made an example with six particles, just to give you a flavor. I just want to convince you this is something which you do not find naturally in an ion trap. Yeah, this is something you have to make. Because here the first two ions, they interact with a strength of 4 in arbitrary units, okay? And but the second and the third interact with a strength of 3, and then the third and the fourth only with a strength of 2 and 1, and these not at all. Yeah, and so this is the interaction which linearly decreases to the right. But if you look how strongly everybody interacts with its left ion sitting in the trap, it's linear. Yeah, I mean it's constant. So it's a very strange interaction, and this is where your toolbox for engineering interactions comes in. And for now, I simply tell you, I mean, I could give you a whole quantum optics talk about the toolbox, how to efficiently and robustly implement funny interactions. But here, I just want to say we have a way of doing this in a very efficient way, also in a way that is very robust, where we can apply error filtering. So error filtering in a way that is not exponential, but nicely only linearly. And an added value of encoding is, of course, I don't have to put another ion for representing the gauge fields. I put only ions for representing the matter fields, yeah, so the saving valuable qubits. And yeah, so we can make an efficient digital scheme with this, with a trotterization. I think most people know trotterization. Basically, I define myself a set of target Hamiltonian. I have a target Hamiltonian, I have a resource Hamiltonian. Resource Hamiltonian on the platform. In our case, our good toolbox for the trapped ions that we used as resources was entangling gates, which are the Milma-Sørensen interaction here. So you see it's already two-body. It's already infinite range. So our worry is only that here you have like a global coefficient, and we have to engineer like the individual weightening factors of this interaction, like we manipulate the range dependence. Yeah, and we have in ion traps very fast and very good high fidelity local operations, which helps a lot. So these were our ingredients. This is how the system looked like. And yeah, so I'm skipping over how the protocol looks in detail. So if you're interested in these gory details, I'll be happy to have some background slides on this later on. For now, let me outline what you really observe in the experiment, so what is actually happening. So this experiment was with 4 qubits, but experimental progress is fast. So let me tell you already now, the new experiment which is going on right now in Innsbruck, I think as we speak, yeah, has 12 ions. Yeah. So the new experiment, so it's still unpublished, but we're already in paper writing mode, so we hope that this will come out soon. As I said, already has 12 ions, but this is the old experiment which had 4. The idea is it was prepared in an easy state, in the vacuum state. I mean, it's not the original vacuum. I mean, it's a bare vacuum. It's a mass infinity vacuum, just complete absence of particles. So let me already stress, in the new experiment, the starting state is prepared in the true physical vacuum, which is an eigenstate of the full Hamiltonian, and which is a complicated entangled state. But so for this old experiment, we start from the state. We rapidly switch on the Schwinger Hamiltonian, which I just introduced to you, and which we can do efficiently. Yeah, so what happens? You have your vacuum, your bare vacuum, you switch on your Schwinger Hamiltonian, then you will get pair creation processes. And as I hopefully convinced you before, like a pair creation takes the form of flip-flops. So you get a configuration, yeah, of course you get a whole superposition, but the term of this superposition might, for instance, look like this. So where 2 and 3 have flipped and flopped, 3 and 4 have flipped and flopped, and so you have created a pair. I can define myself a particle density number operator to count these pairs, and this is then what happens in the ideal case. I mean, this is now the theory curve. Here is time in dimensionless units, and here's the particle number density. Of course, we start with 0 because we started with the state. You see, particle number density goes up, and because there are pair creation processes, at some point, there are too many particles around, and they can also annihilate each other, so particle number density goes down again. Yeah, this is just a reminder of the Hamiltonian, and this dimensionless time is just time multiplied by this rate of particle production. And of course, we do a Trotter time evolution where we discretize time, so we make an error. I mean, even if the Innsbruck guys had the perfect experiment, yeah, we wouldn't make an error because we're discretizing time. Yeah. So this is still a perfect curve, still calculated with Python. Yeah. And so you see, if these are typical step sizes that you can do well in experiments. Yeah. So you already see a deviation only because we don't make the step size infinitely small. Okay, now these are actual experimental data, and they have small error bars. It's data after post-selection, so we're doing some error filtering. I'll be happy to talk about this later on. So this is if you do our Trotter sequence. The Trotter sequence has also nice properties. The Trotter errors are all gauge invariant. Yeah, so you don't introduce gauge invariant state, but Trotter errors is also a nice feature. And we can model this, and we also have a simple error model, and we understand pretty well what is going in this experiment. So here you can see this is a demonstration of the coherent real-time dynamics, how particles and antiparticles are created. You can do it for different masses. There was a full mass scale scan. It's nice about this experiment that you can do it because, changing the mass is only changing local terms, and you see exactly what you expect. Like if you make the mass more expensive, of course you get less particle production. You can also look at the experiment with entanglement. I have to make another disclaimer here. Everything which I talked about, particle number density, is simple to measure because you measure local magnetizations. It's like just local measurements. Yeah, but since we have a small number of qubits and just for the fun of it, we can look at entanglement. Of course, if I would have a larger and larger, larger system, I mean, I don't have the full density matrix anymore. It will not be so easy for me to look at entanglement at larger system. So I want to make a distinguish between everything up till now was super scalable. Yeah, there's just one slide which is not so scalable. Because it requires a full density matrix and hence a full state tomography. So here I'm plotting the logarithmic negativity, which is a good entanglement measure even for mixed states. And believe me, we have mixed states here, pretty much so. So here I introduce a bipartition between the left and the right half of the system and evaluate the entanglement. And so what you find, also you can prove, and we have proven, and you will find the proof in the appendix of the long paper that the entanglement in the spin system is actually the entanglement in the original system, which in the beginning is not so crystal clear because you make a couple of highly non-local transformations, but the entanglement in the spin system is actually the entanglement in the Schwinger model. Okay, so you see here entanglement, it grows because entanglement is created as you create pairs, and this is also as expected. So if you make the mass larger, it's harder to create pairs, so with increasing mass you produce less entanglement. But I can also play with this parameter. This tells me how much the electric field costs me. Yeah, because if I create a pair, I do not only create the fermions, I also create the electric field in between, right? And if I make this pair like larger, then there will be more electric field string in between. And so increasing the cost of these electric fields has an even more pronounced effect, because not only increasing the cost makes it harder, like more costly to generate it in the first place, but also there's less mobility, yeah, because long strings are suppressed. So this is even showing stronger effect. So in the last 5 minutes or so, here's my chairman, okay. In the last 5 minutes, let me tell you something about the other mode of looking at equilibrium problems. This is work that is going on right now, and it's a collaboration between Innsbruck and us at the IQC in Canada. And the basic idea is really to make a hybrid scheme, sync up a quantum state preparator with a classical computer. So you have a certain resource Hamiltonians which live natively in a certain system. And so here I might have long range, but maybe I'm not having long range, and I certainly do not have many body terms beyond two body terms. And here is a classical computer who knows about a possibly very complicated target Hamiltonian. This is in collaboration with the Solar Group. And this is just a summary. The target Hamiltonian can contain difficult terms like three body terms or long range interactions. I have also a set of resource Hamiltonians, and then I create a variational state. Yeah, I start with something which is simple, my initial state that I can just do with high fidelity, and then I'm applying a sequence of my resource Hamiltonians. Yeah, and just a subset of gates that I can do, and these come with certain parameters. For instance, for the local rotations, like how much I can rotate, for the entangling gate, how long I run it. And so this is what I call the variational state, because like I'm making all this recipe. So this is basically, this can be a highly entangled state in the end, yeah? Because I can apply several layers of entangled entangling gates. And the state is, so to say, encoded in these parameters. And these are varied such that this state becomes the ground state of my target Hamiltonian, and this is the cost function which I'm minimizing here. So this is again what happens. I have a certain input variational parameter, and then I have to prepare my state many, many times, because I'm going to evaluate an expectation value, and of course how well I know my expectation value depends on like how many copies I was using here. And this gives me like this expectation value, my cost function, which I'm minimizing with this classical optimization algorithm. And this is again an art in itself, because the classical variation algorithm, it has to deal with noisy cost functions, because there is noise in an actual experiment. And but it can be done. So this is a plot with 8 qubits. There is already a plot with 12 qubits, but I'm not showing it today. And this is really the energy. So you see that the variational algorithm that was used here and that was developed in Innsbruck goes here and finds the certain low state. Okay, unfortunately here an ion was lost in the end. This is why it goes up. But what I want to draw your attention to is that really the measured data, which are the red ones, and the gray data, which are from the classical computer, they really pretty much overlap, and like we're really now able to use this quantum simulator with up to 12 ions to really prepare the ground statements and measure interesting phenomena with this. And yeah, one has again to use a problem-adapted approach. You might want to use symmetries in your variational algorithms that are there in your model. This will make all the difference. And there are also related demonstrations. And I see that my time is already pretty much up. So with this, I leave this as an outlook of ongoing experiments that are currently taking place and that I hope will be online pretty soon. Here I'm advertising European project, QT Flex. So here you see the consortium. So Ignacio and Marie Carmen are also working on this. It's like really about everything that I told you so far. It's about finding sign problem free method for lattice gauge series. And we are currently, I didn't make a slide on this, but we are currently launching a similar effort in Canada. Yeah, so we are launching a whole research effort of bringing together high energy physicists on the one side with people from the quantum community on the other side to build this bridge and really to address problems from high energy physics with quantum inspired methods. And these are the next challenges that we want to tackle in the program that we're currently setting up. So everything that I talked to you so far was 1D. Of course, one of our big challenges and something we're working on now, like really intensively, is to go beyond 1D towards 2D models. Of course, we want to simulate increasingly complex dynamics. We want to include flavors, and we are very interested in including color degrees of freedom. Yeah? So the realization of non-abelian theories is a big point on our to-do list. And much more, yeah. And with this, I want to thank the people who are supporting this effort with money, the agencies, and I'd like to thank you for your attention today.
Good. Time for a few questions.
Oh, we have a lot.
Can you just give a little more details on going to higher dimensions? I mean, what are the challenges and what do you plan to do to address
them? Oh, yeah, the challenges, so there are plenty. Yeah. So we are taking a stepwise approach because rather than going to full 2D immediately, we're going to something that I like to call quasi-2D. So I don't really have, I can't really draw here, but I can. Yeah, so one of the projects that we're looking at is looking at a ladder system. Yeah, so this is not full 2D, and I'm also not claiming that you see full 2D physics here, but for a quantum computer going to a ladder system is the first intermediate step that we can do on this journey. And interestingly, I mean, here you can see we can have magnetic fluxes. Yeah, so this is really the first instance where A, the quantum statistics, the Fermi statistic really comes in, so where Jordan Wigner is not trivial, and also where we have non-trivial magnetic field effects. So here really the like we're doing QED now, and the plaquette terms, the magnetic field terms really play a role, and you see competition between electric and magnetic field effects. So this, even so, it's not the full 2D, is already much richer than the pure 1D scenario. It's richer, but it's also more difficult because something that I was showing you here was we could completely get rid of all the gauge fields. And if I was to do something like this here, I cannot, yeah? I mean, I can, like what we're doing, we're eliminating part of the gauge fields, basically as many as we can, but there are still gauge fields left, yeah? And it also means that it forces us not to take the full Hilbert space into account, because the beauty of this approach is, of course, you eliminate the gauge field, saying it's in the interactions, we have all this infinite dimensional Hilbert space, you have it included, yeah? But here I have some gauge fields left, which I cannot get rid of, so I don't have enough constraints. It also makes sense, no, there has to be a field representing this flux. There has to be a dynamical degree of freedom representing this flux. And so I have to truncate then. Yeah, so I'm going to apply a quantum link model. And but then the challenges are, of course, like how many states do you have to take along in order to fulfill your physics, but still for it to be doable on a quantum simulator, like with ions. So there are like trade-offs. These trade-offs are 2D trade-offs. I didn't have them here, for instance. Yeah.
In your one-dimensional Schwinger model, can you include a topological term, or in other words, an external electric field?
Yeah, we do this, yeah.
I see. Okay.
Yeah, we can and we do. And in one dimension, so let's say our favorite Schwinger model in one dimension, if I include a topological term here, it's particularly simple. I mean, it's so simple that it's even, I'm not even sure whether I would call it a topological term, because then it's just a background field. So it's interesting to study, and this is what we do in the new project, which is running in Innsbruck now, where we add this background field, and then I can look at the parity-breaking quantum phase transition, Coleman's phase transition, and in the from an experimental standpoint, it's really very easy, because since it's a background field, it only gives me local terms, and adding the local terms is, at least from the ion implementation, a piece of cake. Of course, it gets way more interesting as soon as I move to 2D, adding the topological term.
There's some closely related nonlinear sigma models in one space, one time dimension, where the topological term does correspond to an external electric field, and they're very hard to simulate numerically, and they have condensed matter applications, and it's still somewhat open what the behavior actually is, so possibly.
Yes.
The method might be useful for those.
Yeah.
We can discuss it later.
Yes, yes, I'd be very happy to discuss this further.
So concerning your variational approach, maybe you said that, but I missed it. So if you apply an arbitrary number of gates, are you sure you can produce any state?
No, I cannot produce any state because, I mean, there are states where it becomes exponentially costly, but these are models, and in particular, this is a model which is particularly harmless. So here the number of gates grows linearly in the number of particles, but this is also expected for this particular model. I mean, I could write a very ugly model with closing gap or where, I mean, it would be clear that I could not do this efficiently.
But in principle, paying the exponential price, you can produce any state with the sequence of local gates. It's kind of a known result. I don't know.
I'm not sure I understand the question.
If you're ready to pay the exponential price, then you're mathematically sure you can produce any state in Hilbert space.
If you choose your correct gate set, because a priori I'm giving a certain of resource state, set of resource states, and this is nothing that I can completely freely pick. Let's say there are certain platforms and they have certain resource states, gates. And then I'm going to pick my target Hamiltonian. And it's not clear whether I can go from here to there. Like if I want to get the ground state of a target Hamiltonian, like the easiest example is, for instance, if the resource set has more symmetries, then I can combine them in any way, but like I can never move out of the symmetry sector.
But provided you have the good quantum numbers, then...
Like we just made a script for this, just asking ourselves, if I make commutators and commutators of commutators, like the whole Lie group, can I get this Hamiltonian? And if yes, then it's fine. But I mean, I could easily find an example where this is not the case. But on the contrary, if this guy, like the target Hamiltonian, has a symmetry, it's really nice if my resource sets are also having the symmetry, because this is like if I lost my key in my house, but I know it's in the kitchen, then it doesn't make sense to look in the bathroom. No?
Right. Thank you.
Yeah, such a mapping can be done in the non-abelian case, and again, BASIS is a very interesting paper from Munich, again. In the SU2 case, so there's again like an old procedure which can be serve as an inspiration for encoding SU2. So there's a very interesting paper also from Ignacio and Marie Carmen and Stefan and Karl. And so we want to use this as an inspiration to see whether we can again use such an encoding and take it and put it on quantum hardware. But in this case, it's much more challenging than what I showed you today. So this non-abelian case is anyway so much more challenging, yeah, because what I showed you today, in principle, one could have done it differently. Like, there are so many ideas, like people like to put energy penalties, for instance, in the abelian case. Yeah, so you just add a term which completely discourages or makes it expensive to walk out of the subspace. And, of course, maybe you don't want to do it because in the physics is only right in the low-energy subspace. But you cannot even, in the non-abelian case, just carry this over, because then you would run into a very ugly fine-tuning problem, yeah, because the Gauss laws do not commute. Sorry? So you're saying I have like this Hamiltonian could be realized in linear time. This is true.
Yeah,
I lose some time, but I mean it's linear. Yeah.
You could also think about imposing these local
constraints. Yeah.
Sorry? You have n?
Yeah, I have n gauge constraints, yeah, and people have... Yeah, so with there are other reasons why I would be hesitant to use energy constraints. One of them is that from a quantum optics standpoint, you get these the relevant terms only like they're very weak, and then your main problem is that you're dominated by noise and that you will not see the relevant physics. But this is a practical problem. I mean, not one that exists in an only on paper. So this is one of the main reasons why I would be hesitant to use the abelian in the abelian case to use energy penalties. So this is in this case. If I move to non-abelian, I have a much more severe problem with the fine tuning, because I need to impose non-commuting constraints like at the very same time. And there it will basically just not work for more fundamental reasons. And this is why I think the encoding approach is a very promising one. Even so, I cannot promise you like that it works for real in an actual that it will work for real in an actual experiment, because we haven't figured out the details yet. It looks promising, but I can't promise too much.
Okay, I think we should probably break for lunch, but let's thank the speaker again.